Hello, friends. Of late, I have received many messages requesting that I take a stance and elaborate on the ever-growing institution of gay rights, child adoption by gay couples, and all the public manifestations around this newly founded institution, all of which most consider to be a dubious breach on social normality, yet public outcry or public dissent is often muffled, lest someone be called biased, homophobic, and the like. Personally, I have homosexual friends and cousins for whom I have great respect as human beings and unique personalities in themselves. Besides, some of the world's greatest artists and composers, such as our own genius composer here in Greece, Manos Hadzidakis, are gay, and have contributed and contribute so much to the arts and civilization. So they should not be marginalized by all means. However, since any stance that I may take might be dubbed as subjective or even misinterpreted as biased, I will use the only means historically proven to shed philosophical and semantic light on any issue related to life, society, and civilization in general. The tool is the language whose vocabulary is so deeply ingrained in all modern tongues, without whose diction Western civilization would revert to the Bronze Age. It is the same language that once led English scholars to coin the phrase, "The Greeks must have a word for it," still used whenever one is at a loss to name a novel issue or a new invention or discovery. And it is true, through its unparalleled plasticity, Greek is a wonderful tool in that it can perpetually name new things, clarify matters, and disambiguate any controversial issue so as to guide human actions, decisions, and mindsets through its logos. Reason, hence the word logic. This is why, unlike English and other non-Greek tongues, the vocabulary understood by the intelligent speakers of Hellenic dictates what should be accepted as desirable and what should be eschewed. And although many of these Greek words function in the very warp and woof of other tongues, like English per se, the speakers of these tongues have little access to their original semantics, since the Greek compounds that form these meaningful words, literally meaningful words, do not function as derivatives in barbaric tongues. This blatantly means that non-Hellenophones have no access to their didactics, just as very few speakers of English know that the term barbaric literally means one who does not speak Greek, since to the Hellenes, foreign tongues reached their ears as barbar in antiquity. If barbarous or barbaric later came to mean uncivilized, it was quite apropos, since one who has no access to the Greek meanings and values that gave birth to Western civilization is indeed a barbarian, or a semi-barbarian at best. And this does not exclude many modern Greeks who use the language as they take it for granted, without digging deep to find the meanings themselves. So I'm speaking about intelligent speakers of Greek. And no, Greek, unlike Latin, is not a dead language. In fact, all reputable linguists attest to its unbroken development and continuity since antiquity, with over 90% of its modern vocabulary tracing itself back to the days of Homer. Keeping all this in mind, as a bilingual with an erudite command of both English and Greek, I dare say, I will address the issue of whether it is logical to institutionalize gayness and travesty as normality through the didactics of Greek words ingrained in all Western tongues, but are hidden from those who have not been brought up or studied Greek in depth. Let's take, for instance, the issues I have been asked to address. The recent legalization of same-sex marriages, the legalization of child adoption by homosexual couples, and like manifestations, like gay parades, and filter them through the Greek logos, word reasoning process, which coined the word logic. In the case of gay marriage and gayness in general, for instance, the question may be whether it is natural, logical, or even normal to institutionalize it and therefore incorporate it into society. In Greek, the word for nature is physis, as we say, physiological. When suffixed with logos, also known as logic, it forms the word physiologikon in Greek, natural, logical, per se, which means normal in Greek in general. Physiologikon, physiological, means normal in Greek. And it is truly a much better choice than the English word for normal, which stems from, which stems from the Latin root norma, simplistically meaning, originally, carpenter's square. Once a carpenter's square was used to regulate the feet of furniture, to regulate things. A word root hardly charged with any thought-provoking guidance. Hence, many questioning the normality of anything, because many people say, so who can say what's normal? Greek, on the other hand, leaves no room for doubt. For although it acknowledges that homosexuality is a natural phenomenon, using the word physikon, since anomalies do exist in nature, even cancer is a natural phenomenon, Greek excludes it from normality because it cannot be suffixed with logos, with logic, as it does not adhere to the logic of nature, since no human organism can naturally reproduce itself through same-sex intercourse, because this is the logic of nature, its own perpetuation. Keeping in mind that human societies formed and flourished natural logically, physiologikos, through the process of selection rejection, it is not natural logical to institutionalize anomalies within its groups. Doing so simply asserts the demise of its once natural logical structure, which played a vital role in our moral institutions. By institutionalizing abnormality, anomaly, we essentially demoralize society, therefore, reverting it to barbarism. Meanwhile, the Greek word for abnormal, as I said, is anomaly, anomalos in Greek, loaned to English as anomaly or anomalous. It is interesting to note that here, once again, the Greek root has something of value to teach us. Since it stems from homos, which means same, as in homosexual, the same sex, when negated by the privative prefix an, negative prefix, it refers to that which deviates from the common order of things. In Greek, the term also refers to whatever does not function or run smoothly, like a bumpy road, let's say. Ergo, a society encumbered by anomaly is a far cry from what is desirable for the smooth running of its institutions. Quite bumpy, I would say. But maybe the most potent of Greek words that clearly states that no harmony can be produced through institutionalizing anomaly and teaching it in our schools, for that matter, as something natural, logical, is the word harmony in itself. Although the word exists in all civilized tongues, there's not one civilized language that does not refer to harmony to mean something peaceful, but it is much more to it than that. Only one acquainted with Greek knows that its root is harmos, which means nexus, the point at which two things meet, the connecting point. And only one who is acquainted in Greek literature or mythology knows that harmony was personified as the daughter of absolute yet compatible opposites, since only opposites attract and unite in the natural logical order of things. When Aphrodite appeared on Mount Olympus, this really sexy goddess, all the gods rivaled for her favors. To put a stop to this rivalry, Zeus decided to apply political correctness by giving her to the ugly, lame god Hephaestus as a wife, so that no one would be jealous enough to fight over her, in fact, feeling sorry for her for being married to that ugly man. Married to Hephaestus, she was, but that was not enough to keep her from her lover and complete opposite, Ares, the god of war. The politically correct marriage bore no fruit, bore no descendants, whereas her extramarital liaison with Ares produced her beautiful daughter, Harmony. The myth itself goes beyond just dictating what it takes to achieve harmony, since it also stipulates that politically correct actions are doomed to failure, discord, and sterility. A good example is that of classical Athens, that flourished because it had done so eclectically in all respects. It was eclectic with who had the right to be an Athenian citizen and who had the right to hold any governmental post or position. Although homosexuality and anomalies were acknowledged and evident in some Athenian circles and dealt with in a civilized manner, many of them were embraced in society. Society at large condemned them to the point of the archons passing laws such as not allowing anyone proven to have partaken in homosexual acts to hold a post in government. It is, therefore, a question of qualitative reasoning that ordains what is socially healthy and what is not. It is so interesting that the very word eclectic, which I have just used, is Greek and stems from the root legin, which means to choose what lies before us as a choice, and is related to the root logos, that is, logic. It's not by chance, I believe. Therefore, logic, reason, should always be applied in our choices. And what better reference for reason than the adoption of the forces that perpetuate life, Mother Nature herself? Homosexuality plays no role in this perpetuation and should therefore not be institutionalized, let alone peddled as acceptable in our schools and taught to our children as such. That is not to say that a person should not have the right to exercise his or her sexual preferences discreetly in a dignifying manner, but by all means, this preference should not be paraded as a natural logical paradigm to be embraced by our children and society at large. To sum up, I would like to quote the great Athenian philosopher Antisthenes, who once said, "The principles of wisdom lie in the study of words." He spoke Greek. A couple of thousand years later, English academic David Crystal wrote an article entitled "English as a Classical Language." He justifies in his own way what Antisthenes contended. Mr. Crystal stipulates that English is so imbued with Greek and Latin that it cannot function without them. However, I beg to differ on his claim that English is a classical language, since borrowed Greek diction into English has been filtered out of its didactic content. And as such, it is still semi-barbaric, a Germanic tongue globally mongrelized by borrowing from all other languages to the point of homogenizing mindsets that no longer respond to the true meaning of things, but to sounds which cater to the political correctness of our times. So if one needs to access the truth of wisdom, he or she must endeavor to get it from the horse's mouth. And the horse is not Trojan, my friends. It is definitely Greek. Thank you for listening.